Hey guys, Sean T. Phillips here with my brand new DVD Blu-ray Tuesday Shambo today. Taking a go out today, see what things came out, see what things are on sale. Today though, some of the big releases that come out is Happy Death Day to You. That one releases today, as well as Cold Pursuit and Fighting With My Family. There's also one thing that I believe Walmart should have, this horror title. Hopefully they're going to have it in there. I'm not sure if they will. It's one of those things I feel like that would be like the only place that would have it if, you know, if anyone was going to carry it in store. Also though, at the end of this video is going to be a whole bunch of brand new DVD and Blu-ray reviews, so some really cool stuff I received to review and talk about for you guys. Some really cool horror titles, as well as a whole bunch of other things as well. So as always too, let me know in the comments below though what you guys thought of the new DVDs and Blu-rays that are reviewed at the end of this video. You know, what you guys thought of them, if you guys have seen any of them, and if you guys plan on picking any of them up. But anyway though guys, let's get going and see what we can find today.
Into Walmart we go.
And I know I'm at Walmart first. I normally start at Target. I actually did just go there a second ago and they didn't have anything at all out. There was like all these employees in there, some kind of like big employee meeting with all these like managers and stuff. They were like kind of like just restocking and scanning all the old stuff, all like doing like inventory or something. So yeah, nothing was changed out in there. So might go to another Target later though. But in here though, like I said, the big things that came out today was Cold Pursuit. That one's on 4K, and that one's $24.96 for the 4K. And then the Blu-ray of that one's $19.96. And then the DVD is $14.96. I actually really like this movie. And this is actually a remake. I didn't see the original movie, but I thought Liam Neeson did a really good job in this movie about this guy whose son was like, he's like a guy who was like a snowplow driver, and like his son was like killed by these guys. They made it look like he was like overdosed on these drugs and everything, and it's basically him going and getting revenge on the people that did this to his son. And it's like he's the guy in the town too, Liam Neeson's character, who no one like has anything bad to say about. He's like helps in the town with things and will plow people's streets for free and stuff if they need help, so no one's expecting him. So like this is all going on and him causing all this havoc and getting revenge while they're trying to find the people, and they have no clue that like it's him, you know, doing all this stuff. It was actually, like I said, really like this one. I talked about this one last Tuesday. Also today this one came out, and this one's $14.96 for the Blu-ray and $12.96, and this is Never Grow Old with Emil Hirsch and John Cusack. And I thought this was really good. This is probably one of my favorite John Cusack movies in a really long time. And it's just like, when it comes to Western movies too, it's like some of them I really like or some of them I really can't get into. This one though was so good and kind of has a vibe a little bit to Ravenous, because it's such a dark movie. And it's like, you know, Emil Hirsch's character is this like, you know, the, I guess he was the guy who like buries people if they die and stuff like that. And there's like no one in this town is dying because it's like a perfect town. But then, you know, John Cusack's character comes to the town and causes all this havoc, and then he starts getting work. Like him and John Cusack and his gang come into town and cause all these problems. But I really like this one. Highly recommend you guys check this out. The other one here, and they only have, oh, they have a couple of these ones. This one I'm going to get though. I really like this movie, Happy Death Day 2. And I wish they would. I don't know if they're going to get to make the third movie, because I know they. What the thing that's interesting about these films is, like, they want every one of them to be kind of different. Like, the first one was more of a horror comedy. This one kind of became more of like a science fiction-y horror film. But this one's $22.96 for the Blu-ray, and then $17.96 for the DVD of that one. But like I said, I really like this movie. This one I would definitely recommend you guys check out. Also today though, the movie that stars Dane Cook here, American Exit, comes out, and he did a good job in this movie. I like Dane Cook in like dramatic kind of serious roles. Like he was really good in Mr. Brooks, but I thought he did a good job in that. Other than that, in here today, like I was saying, Fighting With My Family, that released today. And this is like the true story of Paige, the WWE superstar, and kind of her family and how she ended up getting into the WWE. Another one, highly recommend you guys check this one out. That one's $22.96 for the Blu-ray, and then it's $17.96 for the DVD. But this is one of the things that came out today, which is kind of interesting. It's Backdraft 2. And I don't believe this has anybody from the original movie in that. That one's $14.96 for that. And it's like, and this one's actually rated R. I think the original movie, I might be wrong, was only PG-13. Let me see if it shows on here. No, the original was rated R as well. For some reason, I was always convinced, I don't know why, that it was PG-13. Like, I never actually even saw the original movie. I don't know how I never saw it. But I remember they had the Universal ride for that, like the show kind of thing. Other than that, in here, this one released today, which I don't know anything about though. This one here, Apollo 11. If you guys have seen this one, let me know how this one was. And that one there is See, that one's 1996. Also, Lifelike, that one released today. And this is a pretty interesting kind of like an Ex Machina kind of movie about this couple, this her boyfriend, Addison Timlin's character's boyfriend's like father died, and he had like all this money and everything. And like he inherited this business, and they had like this robots division of it and everything. And they have this robot kind of helping around the house, and some really weird stuff happens. This one was today as well, Ashes in the Snow. It's another one, I don't know anything about this one, as well as today. Let's see, there's a couple other things. This one, Black Hawk Down, The Untold True Story, which is a Mill Creek release. That one is here for $9.99. This is another one, The Least of Three. I don't know, a Stephen Baldwin movie? I don't know anything about this one as well, but they do have the other one that I wanted to get. This one here for $12.96 called Boo. Some of the executive producers of Insidious. I don't know, this one looked kind of interesting. It's one of those ones that when you look it up on Walmart, like I said, I wasn't sure if they were gonna have it because you can't find, it's like not on the site. So often, like when it comes to like some of the horror titles, you know, you can't find them on there, which is really kind of an odd thing. But yeah, glad they have this one. And I believe this was today as well, this Triple Threat for, I think so. I'm pretty sure that one was for $14.96 for the Blu-ray and then $12.96 for the DVD. Other than that though, I don't think there's anything out. No, I think the other thing today was Godzilla on 4K. This is one of those movies though, I don't know if you guys remember it the same way, but I always remember like seeing this movie in the $5 bin over there. Like when I think of like the $5 bin, this is like one of those movies I always remember because this was always in there. Of course it was the DVD of it back in the day. And I also remember Spice World in there as well. But this is like the number one movie when I think of $5 bin, I always remember that. And I saw that in theaters, I thought it was okay. I felt like the Puff Daddy song I kind of like more than the movie, you know what I mean? But it was okay, but not something, I don't know, it's one of those ones I never really wanted to watch again. Other than that though, in here, they did change out the section here because they didn't have these changed out last time in this particular location. This is some movie over here. Another, what is this movie here called Hoarders? And this is like some kind of a zombie movie. Reality TV, this one looks kind of interesting. I might get this one as well. I've heard absolutely nothing about this one. Like I said, they didn't have this one. They didn't change up the section last Tuesday or any of the in the other Walmart changed some of the stuff, but not this one. So yeah, I might get this one, this Hoarders one. This looks kind of interesting.
Yeah, so I ended up getting all three of those ones. I got Happy Death Day 2 here, that movie Boo, which, like I said, it looked kind of interesting. I actually like this cover of this one, too, because it's just sort of like this goofy, weird, like, you know, Beetlejuice, you know, ghost sheet cover. And then this one, Hoarders, like I said, this one of those ones, I know absolutely nothing about it. It may, like, be not good at all, but it has, like, this cheesy cover and looks kind of interesting about, like Hoarders, like, reality stories of, like, this hoarder house or something. But if you guys have seen that one, though, let me know how that one was. Same with Boo. But you know, with Happy Death Day 2 though, like I said, I really like this series. I do hope they get to make the third movie because I'm interested to see like where they'll go with the series though. But yeah, like I said, picked up these three ones. Probably not gonna go to Target since I end up finding these things, and like I said, they didn't change anything out. And the other one, I don't think they're gonna have anything different today because there's no like exclusives or anything at Target today. And this past weekend, I saw a couple of different films. The first one I saw was The Hustle, which is the remake of, you know, Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, which, you know, originally starred Steve Martin and Michael Caine. That one, though, was actually a remake as well. I never saw the original movie that Dirty Rotten Scoundrels was based on. Let me know in the comments below, though, how that one was, if any of you guys have seen that one. But essentially, though, this one now, it stars, you know, Anne Hathaway and Rebel Wilson, and they're both con artists, and they, you know, that's kind of how they make their living. Anne Hathaway's character, though, is, like, super rich at it and has been doing it for a long time, making a lot of money, conning really, really rich men and getting money from them and everything. And Rebel Wilson, they both basically meet on a train together, and they're both going to the same area, planning to kind of con men in that area. And, you know, Anne Hathaway's character notices Rebel Wilson on the train conning this man out of money, and, you know, they sort of start talking, and she tries to figure out how to get rid of, you know, Rebel Wilson's character and trick her into saying, you don't want to go to this area where the train's going to because, you know, there's no one there, you're not going to make any money. And, you know, of course, though, she gets rid of her, but then she ends up showing up in the town. And they're kind of competing with each other and have this rivalry, and then are kind of also kind of working together as well. And like, you know, Anne Hathaway's kind of trying to mess around with, you know, Rebel Wilson's character and stuff. It's all kind of problems and stuff, but
What's funny though is when it comes to like remake wise, it really is like an actual like total remake where they basically were just sort of changing around some of the details, but the way the movie goes, it was like pretty much like exactly the same. And there's even some stuff that was like shot for shot exactly how things went in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. So there wasn't like a ton of new like surprises or anything in it. I still did think there was some funny stuff in it. It wasn't like absolutely perfect, and I wish too, like, you know, Anne Hathaway's character was like, you know, you would see kind of when she was meeting this guy, these men, and like just about to get married, but they didn't show like their actual initial meeting as much as I was hoping they would. I wish there was a little more of some of that kind of stuff. It was just kind of cutting to points where they were getting ready to get married, and then she found a way to get the ring and all these certain things. Like, I still did think it was worth watching. Like I said, it just wasn't absolutely perfect or anything. The other one that I saw was Pokémon Detective Pikachu, which, you know, of course stars Ryan Reynolds as the voice of Pikachu, and I thought he did a good job. And it really, you know, he in doing this role, and it wasn't like the voice you were expecting to have be voicing Pikachu. But essentially though, it's about this kid whose father is a cop, and he ended up, you know, dying, and he ends up going to the big city to, you know, where his father worked. You know, he had like a sort of a strange relationship with his father and hadn't seen him in a long time. So he goes there to kind of go to the father's house and kind of get things in order and everything. And this is set in a world though where Pokemon and humans are all, like, been for hundreds, like thousands of years, have been, you know, living together and like been friends and everything and kind of working together and everything. And of course, though, this kid has never had a Pokemon. He's never really had a lot of luck with them. But if he goes to the city, though, and it kind of comes to find, you know, Pikachu, who was his father's partner on the force, and there are some strange circumstances about how the father died, and Pikachu is, you know, thinking that, you know, the father might not be dead, and they're kind of on the case, both of them working together, trying to figure out where the father is and maybe what had happened to him. I actually liked it. I feel like even if you guys haven't followed Pokemon at all, this one kind of, mainly the Pokemons that it's showing are like the early on, like Pokemon like from the very beginning. There are some of the newer ones in there, like mixed in the background and everything, but I feel like even if you knew nothing about Pokemon, you'd still find this to be a fun movie. That's like, because I didn't know a ton about Pokemon, and I still thought it was a really fun movie all around. But if you guys have seen either of those movies though, let me know in the comments below what you guys thought of them, or let me know as well like what movies you saw this past weekend, if you guys got to check anything out.
Into Best Buy we go.
Yeah, and in here today, like I was saying though, you know, Godzilla came out in 4K, but they have in here an exclusive 4K steelbook of that one here. This has like the original poster image on this one. I believe this was the original poster image. That one here is $24.99 for that one. And they have in here this Apollo 11 one as well. Like I said, if you guys have seen this one, let me know how this was. I don't really know anything about it. I'm pretty sure it's a documentary, but hadn't really heard much about it, like review-wise or anything. Let's see though, over on the other side here. Let's see, this was one of the other exclusive ones that came out today. Field of Dreams, the 4K one. That one is, you know, has exclusive steelbook of that one. That one's $21.99 for that. And they have Fighting with Our, you know, with My Family as well. That one's $22.99. And then they have Cold Pursuit. That one is $24.99 for the 4K, and then $19.99 for the DVD. And Happy Death Day, that one is $22.99 here. That one seems to be $22.99 everywhere. I was thinking it was going to be somewhere for like $19.99, but I was checking online and didn't seem like anywhere was having this one cheaper though. Everything on the side advertising it. Other than that though, I don't see anything else in here too different. I'm going to head over to the actual section too, just to see if there's anything different over there. And over here though, in the actual section, they have Backdraft 2 here as well. That one's $15.99 for that one. And they have this one released last week, Backdraft, on, you know, 4K. That one's $18.99. Other than that though, over here though, doesn't look like I don't see anything else in here too different today. And like I said, they have those exclusive steelbooks, the two exclusive 4K steelbooks today.
So anyway though guys, that's all for my DVD Blu-ray Tuesday shopping video today. Like I always say, if you guys enjoyed these shopping videos, definitely give this video a thumbs up. Also in the comments below, let me know, you know, what you guys picked up today on DVD, Blu-ray, or 4K. If you guys picked up anything, also be sure to let me know as well what you guys thought of the new DVDs and Blu-rays and 4Ks that I reviewed at the end of this video. Let me know, you know, what you guys, you know, thought of the movies, if you guys have seen them, and if you guys plan on picking any of them up. But anyway though guys, now stay tuned for the brand new DVD and Blu-ray review. And the first one I got here is from Lionsgate. This is the 4K Ultra HD edition
edition here of Crank. This, you know, has the 4K, the Blu-ray, and the digital copy. This one stars Jason Statham, and his character is a, you know, hitman, and he ends up waking up one night. He was like, while he was asleep, he was knocked over the head and injected with this serum that was like basically this poisonous serum, and he, you know, when he gets up, he sees this video that says you were injected with this because of something that you did, and you only have an hour to live, and he's basically, the guy that injected him is like saying, you know, this is it for you. I've finally taken you down and everything. And essentially what goes on though is that what he was injected with is that messes with his like endorphins. So if he ends up like slowing down and he doesn't keep himself moving and keep himself like energized and like drinking energy drinks, driving super fast, doing all these crazy things, like I don't want to ruin all the stuff that he does in case you guys haven't seen the movie, but he just does all these insane stuff, like anything insane possible to keep himself going, because the second he slows down, he'll just drop dead and he will die. But what he's trying to do though is track down the guy that injected him and kind of like try and bring down the operation, as well as seeing his girlfriend. And he has all these certain things that he wants to do before, you know, he ends up dying, because he knows that there doesn't seem like there's really going to be anything that he can do. And it's just him just trying to kind of stay alive for as long as he can and kind of keep it going as much as he can. It's just a really, really super intense movie. I always really, really like this movie. And it's filmed in all these really cool ways, because it's shot like with all these interesting kind of angles, and it's super, super quick cutting. And I feel like this movie definitely had a lot of inspiration for kind of like the vibe of the movie Hardcore Henry, because Hardcore Henry was kind of shot the same kind of super fast-paced, crazy vibe. But this one, like I said, it was shot like in these low angles, these super close-ups of things, kind of like a lot of digital, like different kind of almost before GoPros were around, but kind of like from GoPro kind of angles. Like I said, low angles of like him stepping down on the brakes and like, I don't know, looking up on him and all that stuff. I don't know. This was like one of the first movies to do this. And it also kind of has the editing style of the movie Spun a little bit. But I absolutely love this movie in 4K wise though. This movie really benefits in 4K, because like I said, it's filmed like mixed media with these different kind of cameras and the way it's shot. And it really looks better than it ever has before, especially like some of the stuff like for example, like there was one scene of it when he was in this one area, and the one guy was like, it was like this real smoky room, and he was like smoking a cigarette, and the way it was, the lighting and everything looked so cool in 4K that it did not look like that when I watched this one on Blu-ray years back. But you know, if you guys have 4K capacities, this is one I would definitely recommend. It also has some exclusive features on here for the 4K. It still has the features on the Blu-ray as well though, the original features, which has like Shooting Crank, a featurette on it, the Stunts of Crank. But on here, the stuff that's new that was never released before, it has more stories from Crank, which is more stuff about the making of Crank, as well as one thing that's really cool, which is Crank at Comic-Con. And I actually was at that Comic-Con panel. I think it was in 2000 and I think it was actually 2006, and at the same time, it was a panel that also doesn't have that on there, but I believe the panel originally had Crank, and also had, I think, Saw 3 was on the panel, and as well as the movie Skinwalkers. I think those were the three movies that were like being promoted at that panel, but I always remembered seeing that, and that was early on for, this was an early on Jason Statham movie. This is probably like one of the earlier things that I remember personally seeing him in. I think I believe it probably was, but like I said, really cool that was included on there. And next one here is from Lionsgate as well. It's a movie here starring John Travolta called Trading Paint. This is basically though about John Travolta's character, who was this race car driver, and he had some success. He really did have a very big streak of being successful with it, but he kind of turned it over to his son, and his son started doing the racing, and his father was helping him kind of with the car and getting everything figured out and helping him kind of plan out the races and those kind of things. But this streak, though, that his son's winning streak had been going down. He wasn't having too much success anymore, and kind of like didn't really know what he wanted to do. He was also working for his father at this mechanic shop, and he kind of had to like do kind of what the father was saying, because since he was working with him and then having him help him with the races and everything, he kind of had to do as his father was saying. But he ends up getting offered a job for Michael Madison's character, who ends up working as like he's like a rival team that he runs, and he ends up getting offered to, you know, be the race car driver for that team. And like
But he knows that if he goes and does that, that since he works for his father, you know, John Travolta's character, he knows that John Travolta will fire him and it'll be a big falling out and the father probably won't talk to him again. But he ends up, you know, because he really wants to continue on, his, you know, John Travolta's son wants to continue on with race car driving and hopefully be more successful. He ends up going with Michael Madsen's team and it becomes this whole big thing between his, you know, John Travolta and his son. And they have this huge falling out. And then, like, John Travolta's character is trying to figure out, like, what he's going to do about, since his son's no longer racing for him. And, you know, his character was a race car driver and, like, was successful in the past. And now he's kind of looking into seeing if he might actually continue on and now start racing again. And it would end up being, like, races that would be between him and his son competing against each other. It was actually a pretty interesting character piece here. Like I said, this is one here called Trading Paint, starring John Travolta. And the next one I got here is from Universal, and it's a movie here called The Upside. This one here is a remake of a French film called The Intouchables. If you guys have not seen that one, really love the original movie as well. This one stars Kevin Hart, Bryan Cranston, and Nicole Kidman. This is about Bryan Cranston's character, who's this guy who, you know, has all this money, runs this company, is a super successful person, but ended up recently was in an accident and has become paralyzed. And because of that, you know, his assistant, played by Nicole Kidman, is kind of helping him try and find someone to come in there and be, you know, kind of work for him and kind of be his caregiver and help feed him, help with his day-to-day activities and all these certain kind of things. But Bryan Cranston's character, though, is really depressed, and he's kind of purposely wants to get someone that's, like, not right for it, because he does kind of hopes the person messes up, because he doesn't really want to continue living. He's just in a really, really terrible way and really depressed because of what had happened to him. But he ends up meeting Kevin Hart's character, who comes there for a job interview, and he actually doesn't even know what he's doing. He thinks he's going in there for an interview to be a janitor in the building, because he's never done anything like this before. He kind of messes up and goes to the wrong area and everything. So he has no clue what he's going there for. And, you know, he ends up getting the job, though, even though he knows nothing about taking care of someone who's paralyzed or in a situation like that or anything like that. He has no clue what he's doing. But like I said, Bryan Cranston's purposely doing that because he's kind of hoping that he messes up because of the way he's in and how upset he is. And essentially, though, when Kevin Hart comes there, though, he doesn't know exactly what he's doing. And Nicole Kidman's character really doesn't like him because she knows that he doesn't know what's going on and know how to take care of him right or anything. And he's kind of like told to do certain things. He's like, well, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. That's not something I would do. So there's all sorts of kind of scuffles and problems going on. But essentially, though, Kevin Hart's coming there and kind of helping Bryan Cranston, kind of helping him go out and do things, helping him kind of, you know, look at the positive things in his life and looking for, like, dating and all these kind of things that he never thought that he would do, and just sort of helping him out. And it becomes this friendship between them. It's a really, really good movie. And also, though, I really thought Kevin Hart did a really, really good job in this, because it's a very different role for him, because it's a much, you know, there is some comedy elements in the movie, but it's got way more of a dramatic sense. And I thought he did a really good job with the dramatic aspects of this movie. But on here, though, it has a bunch of different features. It has on here deleted scenes. It has a gag reel. It has an on-screen chemistry thing on here with talking about Kevin Hart and Bryan Cranston, as well as to other featurettes as well on this one. Also a thing on here talking about how this is a different kind of role for Kevin Hart, but one I would highly recommend you guys check this one out. The next one here is from Screen Media. And this is a documentary series, which is from on Netflix show called Netflix Presents, you know, The Toys That Made Us. This is the DVD here, and it has season one and season two of this. This is actually a really cool show. This is a documentary all about toys. And it has on here, eight different episodes. It has one on Star Wars, one on Barbie, He-Man, G.I. Joe, Star Trek, Transformers, Lego, Hello Kitty, and also has on here deleted scenes, a deleted scene from the Star Trek episode. But essentially, though, what this is, for example, like with the Star Wars episode, it talks all about the toys for the Star Wars films and kind of how they, you know, went through, like, the production and how, like, they didn't even know if they were going to get the toy, you know, because at the time, you know, when the first Star Wars movie came out, they never knew how successful it was going to be. And they ended up, you know, talking about how the company that was not a big company at the time, you know, went in and designed the toys. And it kind of talks all about, like, the fandom of toys, toy collectors. It talks to the creators of the toys and kind of how they were made.
made and kind of some of this like behind the scenes stuff, some of the things that went wrong, prototypes, all that kind of stuff. Like I said, interviews with the fans, showing big collections and kind of showing like the rare, some of the rare toys, the ones that are like the sought after ones, the most valuable ones. If you guys are fans of toy collecting and toys in general, this was actually a really, really cool documentary. Really, really like this one a lot. And next one I got here is from Movie Zing, and this is a Warner Archive release, and this is the complete 7th and 8th season here of Perfect Strangers. So now the complete series of Perfect Strangers has now fully been released on DVD, which is so cool. Perfect Strangers was a show that I always really liked. You know, this was a show that was on TGIF, and I grew up watching this as a kid. I only started seeing it though later on though. I didn't see like the very first seasons when it first started, but I watched it later on. And this show is actually the show too that was the Family Matters wouldn't have existed without this show, because the Harriet's character, who is the mom in Family Matters, she was actually on this show in a couple episodes. I think it was like the 3rd or 4th season she was in, or maybe both of them, and she was like the elevator operator at the office that the guys both worked at. And then they kind of like, her character is so popular, she they ended up having a spinoff about her and her husband and everything, and her family, of course, which became Family Matters. This is essentially, though, about these two cousins who are living together, and one of them is from, like, a country that, I don't know exactly what the country is, they never really say it too well, they kind of, like, never want to say exactly what it is, but it's like a strange name they were saying, and I think it was a name that didn't even actually exist or something like that, I remember reading. But essentially though, they both live together and they kind of have all sorts of like problems together, disagreements and work together, and then like they have like relationship problems with the women that they're dating and all sorts of problems. It's a really, really fun show. This, like I said, I always really liked this one, and so glad now we have the completely 7th and 8th season. The 8th season though was a much shorter season. I think it was only like 8 episodes or something like that, but there were a couple different two-parter episodes on that one. But if you guys are a fan of the show, like I said, want to let you guys know that finally all the seasons now have been released. Now the next one here is from Movie Zing as well, and this is from Random Media is the company that released this, and this is a movie here called Eyes and Prize. This is basically though about these, it's four different people who are going into a reality type show, kind of like a Big Brother type show where there's like cameras all throughout the house, but there's something really peculiar about this place. Like they get in there and like and there's a lot of like really long take scenes, like one take scenes where they did a really good job though, because some of the scenes go on for a really long time without any edits or anything. But it's kind of like these four different people all kind of coming into the house in the very beginning, kind of like talking to each other, like, what did you see? Did you see anybody else when you came in? Do you know too much about what's going on? Like what the plan is? They kind of just stumble into this house without really knowing too much, but they see all the cameras and everything. But the last guy who comes in is acting a little strange. He comes in with a key and he's like, oh, I'm told I should lock this. And he's like, I have these papers that I was given. They're like, well, what was the guy that talked to you out there like? Oh, it's just kind of normal. Nothing really different. I didn't really think too much of it. But then, like, right when they get in there, after a few minutes, this is really early on in the movie, the guy, the last guy that comes in, kind of wanders off and, like, opens up this room and goes in there and locks himself in. And you go in that room and there's all these cameras and everything. It's essentially, there's something really odd going on here in this guy, and it's kind of like what he's planning. And there's some really crazy stuff that goes on in this movie. It's kind of like the, totally like intense version of like a Big Brother thing with, like I said, a whole lot of different twists and everything in this. And the next ones here are some really cool Italian releases. Both these ones are from Midnight Factory. And this is from their Midnight Classics line. But this is Wes Craven's The People Under the Stairs. Now, at this one, though, keep in mind, this one is Region B locked. So you guys would have to have an all-region Blu-ray player, region-free Blu-ray player to play this one, because it's Region B locked. But on here, though, I actually believe it has some features that were not on the U.S. Blu-ray that came out a number of years back. Like, I don't recall, though, an interview with, Sean Whalen, that one being on that one, that's on this edition here, as well as an interview with AJ Langer on this one, which I don't believe as well. But there's a whole bunch of other features on this one as well. It's all in Italian, so I don't want to say all the wrong stuff that's on here, but there are a number of different features. Like I said, I'll show you guys a look inside. This is always, though, one of my top favorite Wes Craven movies. I've always really loved this movie. It always really creeps me out as well. It's just a very creepy concept. I don't want to say too much about it to like ruin anything, if you guys have never seen this movie, but essentially though, It's about this couple that are very strange, and they kind of like have all this money in this weird house, and they have their daughter in there, and they have like all these, you know, bars on the outside of the window so she can't leave, and there's just some really strange stuff going on in this house. And essentially though, this couple ends up owning all these properties, and like they own stuff like an inner city and everything, and they're trying to evict this whole complex. And the one guy who's, you know, the kid who's living there with his family, you know, him and his, you know, sister's boyfriend, basically though, they're planning to, because they find out about, you know, they're trying to be evicted and they're going to tear down the building and all this kind of stuff, because that family wants to like sell the land and everything. They know about them and all the money they have, so they're planning on trying to get into the house and steal this money from them and everything. And it becomes like this whole big thing, and them going into this house, and it's a horrible situation, them going in there, and it's just an amazing movie. I've always absolutely loved this movie. If you guys have never watched this movie, this is an absolute must watch. But I'll show you guys a little look inside. In here, though, it has another really cool image on here. And like, I don't know, this is a great image on this. Look on the side. But in here, though, it has this little, like, kind of like postcard size thing here with the original poster artwork for the film. And then in here, though, here's the other poster artwork in English here. But inside, though, there's a lot of really great stills from the movie. The one on here, though, here, you know, Roach, and then, you know, Mommy, and then the daughter, and then, you know, this one, this actor, though, I'm always a huge fan of, you know, it's Everett McGrill, you know, who is also in, you know, Silver Bullet, and of course, Twin Peaks, and he recently came back for Twin Peaks The Return, and here's him in this bondage wardrobe in this movie. This is, like, an absolutely crazy, crazy must-watch movie that if you guys have never watched it, it's absolutely something you guys have got to watch, but a really, really cool edition of this one. But like I said, just keep in mind though, this one is region B locked. Also though, from Midnight you know, Factory. Now this one though is region free, so you guys can watch this one, you know, no problem. In the US, you don't have to have like an all region multi-region Blu-ray player or anything like that. This one here is Escape Room. Now this is not the Escape Room movie that recently came out, the most recent one. This one is from 2017. I talked about this one a while back. This is actually a pretty cool movie. Similar to, you know, the more recent film, similar concept, because it's basically though about these people that get invited to this escape room, and then it's this one though, the escape room is like a real pop-up kind of thing that kind of goes around everywhere, and it's like different people who are in there, they're going for this party, like these friends and everything, and there's like, and this one though, this is way more R-rated. So like, of course, they get into this escape room, and literally they start finding out that if they don't get out of the rooms, they end up getting killed. And it's like very, very super gory, you know, deaths and stuff in this one. Like I said, the other film, the most recent escape room movie though, that one's PG-13. This one's, like I said, way more of an R-rated movie. So it's super gory and like some real gross out kind of stuff in here. But it's essentially though, the people trying to figure out how they're gonna get out of this escape room. And there's some interesting kind of twists and stuff in this one. I actually really like this. I'll show you guys a look though inside at the artwork and everything in this one. I always like the way this company, you know, does their layouts and everything. There's also some stills and stuff like that in here from the movie. Like I said, one of the guys on the disc one is available on Blu-ray. The next one here is from Uncorked Entertainment, and the director, you know, Tommy Stovell, sent over this to review, and I was really looking forward to watching this. It's a movie here called Room for Rent, which stars Lin Shaye, and I have to say, this movie was great. Like, I have always been a fan of Lin Shaye forever. Like, you know, she's probably one of my top favorite character actors of all time. Like, she's always good and everything. Like, I think, like, one of the first things I remembered, like, really noticing her in, that I would, like, when I was taking notice of her, like, how great she was and everything, was Kingpin. And she in this movie though, her character puts in this bow at one point, and it was kind of like the bow that she had in Kingpin. So I was thinking about Kingpin when she had this little bow, kind of bow flower thing. It was kind of like a throwback in a weird way to Kingpin. But essentially though, this is about Lin Shaye's character, whose husband had recently died. And, you know, she ended up going to the bank trying to figure out kind of what kind of money that they had left and everything. And it turned out that he ended up, like, you know, investing money and losing money on, like, this loan, and kind of messed everything all up. And then she actually
you know, because of the loan, she actually found that she still had to pay off on this loan she knew nothing about, which was like $4,000 she had to owe, that she was owed, that, you know, she had to pay to the bank, and she had, and there was no money in the savings for her or anything. She didn't know what she was going to do, and she ends up, you know, coming up with the idea, looking online, and sees this magazine when she's in the bank, and to, you know, do like a bed and breakfast. So she ends up having this bed and breakfast at her house. And of course, though, there's something off about her character. She's really odd. And she becomes very clingy and obsessed with the people that come there for the bed and breakfast. And like this one couple that's there, she's like starts talking to the woman there and kind of like giving the husband crap about his weight and everything. And then like, you know, she's just like kind of clingy and like she's also like looking through people's things. But essentially what ends up happening though is this one guy that ends up coming there for an extended period of time is where the person she becomes very obsessed with. And she starts like inventing these ideas about him in her head. And it's a thing I liked was the movie like has these narration scenes that are, cause she's really into like romance novels. So she's kind of like imagining things with this guy in like the way a romance novel would flow when she's like having these inner monologue narrations about like, when she's writing to a certain person. I don't want to say too much about what happens, but she's basically like thinking of like this guy in this romance novel sense. And it was amazing. Like I really, really got into this movie. Would highly recommend you guys check this out. If you guys are fans of Lin Shaye, and keep in mind too, this is not like a movie where like Lin Shaye's only in it for a few minutes or anything. Like Lin Shaye is the full star of this movie. She's in the entire film and did an amazing job, like a great performance in here. There's also this crazy scene of her like getting picked on by these boys, like these like high school boys, which is like this insane scene with what happens and like what these guys are saying. And it was kind of, I haven't seen anything like that ever, I don't think, you know, like a woman that was an older person getting picked on like that. And it was like just like totally nuts, but like really, really love this movie. It has on here though behind the scenes, deleted scenes, and a making of on this one. The next one here is from Dark Sky Films, and it's a movie here called White Chamber. This stars the actress from The Descent. It's basically, though, about, you know, she ends up waking up, her character ends up waking up in this, like, white room where it's, like, this weird, like, it's all kind of white around the walls and everything, and like these bright lights and everything. And she doesn't know what she's doing in there. And she starts like hearing this weird, like muffled voice, kind of like out of like Saul or something, like saying, "You have to tell me about this. You have to tell me about this." So there's certain like secret or something that she knows that this person is trying to get from her. And they're trying to, you know, coach it out of her. And like the room though, it can kind of like heat up and become super hot, like boiling hot, and then it can become super cold, like the floor freezes over and everything. So like the person is kind of like torturing her to try and get this answer. But then it kind of cuts to also dealing with you know, who the person is that is like, you know, the torturer. And then you find out more about it. And like this, the woman who's in there, maybe she knows more about things and she's kind of letting on. You can't say a whole lot about it, but it was actually kind of an interesting kind of movie. Like, I don't know what I would relate it to, but like, it's like sort of like a, like, cause it's like, you know, sort of like a Saw kind of like trapped in one kind of room kind of thing, but like with a lot of different twists and stuff in it, because it's also dealing with like at the same time the world is going through like this, all this bad stuff's going on in the world, so like there's all this other stuff going on as well in the background of what's happening. And like I said, it's actually kind of an interesting different movie here. The next one here is from Wellgo USA. It's a movie starring Donnie Yen called Big Brother. This is basically about Donnie Yen's character, who, you know, his character was like in the army, and he ends up leaving and ends up going to get a job as a teacher. And it kind of has like a Dangerous Minds kind of vibe, you know, with Michelle Pfeiffer's character going to the school, because that's sort of the vibe of this is. But like his character, though, of course, like, you know, has all these special skills from being in the war and everything. But he ends up taking this job as a teacher, and at the school, though, it's kind of focuses on the kids there, and it shows kind of like their problems at home, and kind of like some of them are like involved with sort of bad, like the bad people there at the school, and like also they have like family dramas going on at home and all sorts of things. And he kind of comes in the classroom and kind of helps these kids and trying to help them with his own like teaching ways and sort of trying to help them through their problems. But then there ends up being like some conflicts and stuff like that go on. But like I said, it's got that Dangerous Minds kind of vibe here. But I actually thought
there's this pretty interesting movie here, and a different kind of role for Donnie Yen, though, because it was, like I said, it has like this dramatic kind of stuff of him helping these kids, and there's some like real heavy subject matter that happens in this one. And the next ones I got here are from Severn Films, and this is from the Intervision line. It's a movie here called Mask Mutilator, and this is a lost film that was shot 25 years ago. It wasn't technically lost. It was pretty much shot, and then never anything was done with it. It wasn't edited, you know, or anything like that. The kind of like the film was just kind of left in the producer's basement, and was kind of nothing was ever done with it. But now it's finally been finished, and they shot a new wraparound to kind of tie the movie together with some things that didn't make sense because of some of the things that weren't technically filmed back then. Because the one producer was saying there was all kind of disputes when it was being made and about the direction of the movie, and some weird stuff that didn't fit was shot, and some of that, all these kind of things that had happened. But I'm really glad this was finally edited, you know, and finished, because this is actually a great movie. Like, I really like these kind of weird movies like this. It's basically, though, about this group home for these bad kids, and the group home is run by this guy who was, you know, called the Mad Mutilator. He was a wrestler who, like, was popular, but he ended up, you know, and this person ended up dying in his hands in the ring by a mistake, and because of that, he kind of left wrestling and now is, like, helping these kids and helping rehabilitate the bad kids at this group home, and he's kind of, like, real tough with them, and he doesn't really take any of their crap or anything like that. But essentially, though, at this group home, though, you know, somebody's going in there wearing the Mad Mutilator mask, going around and killing these kids, and there's these crazy deaths, these like super gory over the top deaths and everything in this one. Really, really cool music as well. But this whole vibe of this I really like, because the thing that was funny too was like they're all supposed to be like these teenagers, but everybody looked like they were in their 20s and like seemed kind of old, and like and everything about it, like the acting was kind of peculiar. The one guy though who comes into the group home to kind of start working there was a guy who was in I kept thinking, what was this guy from? And I looked it up, and he was in Class of Nukem High 2 and Class of Nukem High 3. He was like the star of those ones. But essentially, though, it's all, like, the wraparound stuff is, like, one of the kids, like, telling his story now about what had happened in the group home and about all the deaths and everything. But I really like this movie. There's some crazy, like sort of stunt scenes in this as well. And, like, it really has this, like, early 90s vibe to it, which I really liked. It was just so cool. There was, like, this movie that was, like, never finished, finally finished now. And it's actually really cool. I'm so glad, like I said, they finished this movie. It has a bunch of different interviews on here with the producers and the, you know, the writers on this one, and some of the special effects artists and actors. And there's a really interesting one with one of the producers talking about like how this was filmed and all the kind of reasons why it wasn't finished and all this kind of stuff. Some really interesting stuff on this. Also has on here audition tapes and a cast and crew interview on this, but one I would highly recommend you guys check out. It like, even though it wasn't shot on video, it has an old like throwback shot on video vibe. And next one here is from Severn Films as well. It's a movie here called Saint Bernard. This is a really trippy art film here. Kind of has the vibe a little bit of like, because like there was a movie called Valentine or Week of Wonder, which has this like real dreamlike kind of scape to like vibe to the movie. It's all dream, the way it feels and everything. Like it's basically like so someone's dreaming. And this kind of has that same kind of feel to this with these like dreamlike kind of scenes and these super huge set pieces and these like creepy kind of things that people are seeing and everything. It's basically about this guy though who's this music conductor. It's just kind of about him kind of like unraveling and becoming like nuts with these things that he's seeing and these kind of characters that he's coming across, and there's all sorts of weird imagery. It's like one of these movies though you can't really explain this one, you can't explain the plot too well and just say it's a really really trippy out there weird movie. But you know, it has a bunch of cool people in here though. It has Warwick Davis, you know, who was from the Leprechaun films in this one. It has Bob Zumata is in this movie from Man of the Moon, as well as a performance on here from the punk legends The Damned. It has on here feature-wise, though, it has a making of Saint Bernard as well as a theatrical trailer on this one. The next one here is from Severn Films as well. This is a horror anthology film called The Uncanning. This is a movie that's like very similar like in tradition to like classic, you know, anthology horror films like Tales from the Crypt, which I always love that one. This one has a great cast in here. It's got Peter Cushing in here as well as Donald Pleasance. Ray Milland is in this one. But essentially though, this is about this author who's like talking to his publisher about his new book, and he's found out, he's basically discovered that cats are kind of evil and horrible and like, you know, they're kind of controlling things. things. And he's basically, though, just discovered that cats are very bad and, like, not good at all. And he's written, he has three true stories that he says that are in this book that are kind of, and that's kind of the wraparound of this movie, of, you know, cases where cats have done horrible things, like committed murder, revenge, and all these kind of things in it. I always like these kind of movies that deal with, like, you know, evil cats and everything. Like, there's one called Black Cat, and, like, one of the, I think Tales from the Dark Side, the movie, had this crazy cat in it, and, like, you know, Cat wasn't bad, though, but, you know, in Cat's Eye, I don't know, anything, like, with horror cats and stuff like that. This was actually, at the time, though, there really wasn't anything else, like, anthology-wise. I think they were dealing with, like, crazy cats, at least that I can think of. But this is a really, really cool, if you guys are a fan of horror anthologies. Looks really good here on, you know, on Blu-ray. This has on here, though, an interview on here with actress Susan Pathogen on this one, as well as a theatrical trailer. Now, next ones here are from Umbrella Entertainment. Now, these ones are really cool Australian releases. I'm you guys know about. Now, all these ones, except for one of them, is region free. I'll let you guys know which one isn't. But this one here is the Howling 3, the Marsupials. And I always like this movie. The thing with the Howling series is, the first Howling movie always, you know, started off, you know, as a real kind of serious, like, scary movie. And then the second one started getting a little goofier. There was, like, some more kind of goofy kind of stuff. And I also liked the second one that, you know, the actor from Pee-wee who played Mickey, the one that picks up Pee-wee when he's hitchhiking, you know, he has a really big role in the movie. And it's basically, this is from the same director, though, as the second movie. But this one goes in a super, like, way goofier level, which I really liked. I kind of like, I always have a lot of fun with comedy horror movies. That's always, to me, some of the most fun ones to watch, is, like, when it's a horror movie, when it has a lot of comedic stuff in this. This is basically, though, like, about a group of these werewolves, but the one is actually ends up, like, this girl that's a werewolf, like, kind of wanders away from this kind of weird kind of cult area where the werewolves are, and ends up finding her way to this guy who's, like, producing this movie, and, like, he's putting together this film. And she ends up getting a job acting in the movie. So there's some great stuff in here about her, like, acting in this cheesy horror movie. And then, like, she ends up falling in love with the one guy that tells her about the movie. And they plan on wandering off. And it becomes a whole big thing because, like, the werewolves, because she got away from them, from the group of the werewolves, they're coming after her, trying to find her. It becomes a whole big thing. But it's a really, really fun, over-the-top, goofy movie. On here, though, it has a commentaries on here with the director. It has a conversation on here with the director. It has a Not Quite Hollywood, you know, extended interviews with the director and special effects artist. That was the documentary that, you know, Umbrella Entertainment released as well a couple years back. There was a documentary on all the horror movies that were made in, you know, Australia, because there's a lot of really great Australian horror movies that were filmed and, you know, shot in Australia. It also has on here, though, trailers, TV spots, and a press gallery on this one. Also, though, they released this collection here on DVD that has the Howling 4-disc collection here. And this one has on here the Howling 3, the Howling 4, the original Nightmare, Howling 5, the Rebirth, and Howling 6, the Freaks. And this one, though, now all the ones in here you guys can watch on a US Blu-ray player, I mean a US Blu-ray DVD player, except for the Howling 6, The Freaks. That one, you know, when I put that one into the standard, you know, not region-free Blu-ray player I have, it spit the disc out and said that this one is in the PAL format. So, like I said, every one in here that you can watch in the US player except for the last one. And next one here is from Umbrella Entertainment as well, and this one is an all-region release, so you guys can watch this one on any, you know, Blu-ray player in the US or anything. You don't have to have any, like, special player for this one. Same with the next two Umbrella Entertainment releases as well. This one is Death Warmed Up. This is a really, really trippy, out there, crazy, super gory movie. It's basically, though, about this doctor who's doing all these kind of weird experiments that are, like, he's kind of working with this other doctor, and he's getting in these big disagreements with the other doctor about these experiments and, like, kind of the way they're going, because they're going really strange, and strange stuff is happening to the people. And the one kid that was there to see his his dad at the hospital place, and is, you know, he witnesses, like, the two doctors having this big fight, and the one that's having the fight and not agreeing with the way things are done is the kid's father. But essentially what ends up happening, though, is this kid witnesses all this stuff, and this crazy doctor, though, injects the son ends up, you know, killing, you know, somebody. And it's basically, though, like, he ends up committing this murder, and because of that he ends up going to jail, and he goes to, like, the nut house and everything, because it makes him kind of crazy, this, and he doesn't even know remember doing this or committing this crime or killing anybody or anything, but it's because of this injection. And it's, like, years later
later, he ends up, you know, going to this island to try and, like, find this doctor, sort of, and he's also coming along with his girlfriend and his friends, and, like, this it's kind of becomes, like, an Island of Dr. Moreau thing, because this guy is, like, on this weird, secluded island that the doctor now, and he's there doing these strange experiments, and there's all these people that are, like, mutated and have these weird growths on them, and all kinds of strange stuff going on, and it's just this insane stuff going on this island. Like I said, it's got, like, an Island of Dr. Moreau kind of vibe. This one has on here, though, a commentary track on here with the director and writer. It has on here an interview on here with actor David Letch, as well as deleted and missing scenes with optional audio commentary. It has the original New Zealand VHS cut, as well as it has on here theatrical trailers and VHS trailers, TV spot and image gallery. So lots of features on this one. This one is from Unreal Entertainment as well. Like I said, this one is region free as well. This is a movie that stars Dennis Hopper called Mad Dog Morgan. This one here, I think this is from, like, 1976, and this is about the, you know, the true story of Mad Dog Morgan. It's based on, the, you know, kind of like the outlaw. He was trying to find, like, gold and everything, and he was having, like, no luck, and he ended up getting put in jail, and it's kind of about him kind of trying to get on revenge to the people that did this to him, and he's also kind of going around and causing all sorts of trouble, and there's like, this big bounty on his head, and they're kind of people kind of coming after him. It's just this crazy Western movie, and Dennis Hopper is amazing in this movie. Like, he goes totally crazy in this. Like, he always, you know, put himself so much into his roles, and this is one of those ones when he just goes absolutely insane, and it's just, he does such a good job in this movie. It has on here, though, a commentary track on here with the director, as well as with the author, as well as on here it has To Shoot a Mad Dog, The Making of Mad Dog Morgan. It has extended interviews from Not Quite Hollywood on this one, as well as radar interviews with the director on this one, as well as Dennis Hopper interview, trailer, and image gallery. And next one here is from Unbridled Entertainment as well, and this one's region-free as well. It's a movie here called In a Relationship, and this stars Emma Roberts. It's basically, though, about her and her boyfriend. They've been together for a number of years now, and, like, you know, they've kind of not gotten to the point where they've gotten, like, moved in together. And Emma Roberts' character is saying, you know, we should move in together, and he's, like, kind of gets scared of the whole thing and decides not to do it. And it's basically, though, about, like, their relationship falling apart, but then at the same time, you know, his character, you know, Emma Roberts' boyfriend's character's best friend starts to like, you know, Emma Roberts' cousin in the movie. And it's kind of about, like, you know, how it's, like, the polar opposites of, like, a relationship that is, you know, just starting between them, and then their relationship is, like, now falling apart, and it's going in, like, a weird direction and everything. It's kind of all about their relationships and kind of what's going on, and kind of about them, if they're not sure if they really want to not be together, what they're going to do, and all that kind of stuff. It's actually a really pretty good relationship movie, and always a fan, though, of Emma Roberts. Next one here is from PBS. This is The Best of the World's Greatest, or Best of World's Greatest. This is basically going and, like, examining, like, showing these kind of, like, great big, like, kind of like, it has on here, for example, like, lost cities, and it's going and talking about these huge cities that were these gigantic cities that have, like, throughout the years have become totally lost, and kind of like, and, like, they were, you know, had all these people in them, you know, hundreds of years, thousands of years back and everything, and now have become totally lost, and, like, kind of the places, you know, like, treks, these, like, huge treks of people, like, when they go and hike through these huge, kind of spaces and huge places and everything, kind of goes through some of those kind of, like, long treks that people go on. Has ancient cities in here. It shows, like, gigantic volcanoes. So really, really well put together a series here. Like I said, this is a 2-disc set here for the best of world's greatest here. The next ones here are from, this one here is from Widowmaker, and this is called Toughland. This is basically, though, about this girl who wants to kind of get away because of things that are going on in her life, and she ends up getting this job in this, like, it's kind of like a, it's like, they say it's like a textile kind of, place where she kind of goes and gets this job out in the middle of nowhere in this weird kind of, like, commune kind of community, and she doesn't want, like, her friend to tell her mother where she is. She kind of just wants to get away and everything, so she kind of goes there, and she kind of comes to discover, though, where she is, like, really strange. And it says on here it's got, like, in tradition of, like, you know, Rosemary's Baby and The Wicker Man. It definitely has that Wicker Man kind of vibe, and it kind of comes to find out that there's some really strange people there that she's working with that are there in this commune
kind of place, and really weird things are happening. It's a very, very interesting movie here. It has on here, though, behind the scenes and a trailer on this one. The last one here, this is the re-release here of the Camp Motion Pictures film. I'll cover this up because it's kind of gross, of the movie Splatter Farm, which is directed by the Polonia brothers. And I always really liked this movie. If you guys are a fan of shot-on-video horror movies, this is probably one of my favorite shot-on-videos next to, Cannibal Camp Out, and, you know, the John McBride directed, and, you know, the Woodchair Massacre, which I always love shot-on-video horror movies. There's something really fun about them. I really like, you know, old-school synth music, and there's something really cool about these, because they're like, I always have loved, you know, shot-on-video ones. This new edition, though, I don't think when it originally came out, though, it included a disc 2. Disc 2 has another Polonia film, Brothers film here called Monster Movie, which I saw this one years back, but I don't think, though, that one had ever been, you know, I don't think it was in a set like this before, but it also has in here like a booklet, which has some pictures and stuff like that about the movie. There's a lot of real gory stuff in this, so I can't really show too much on this one, but it has a booklet in here, which I don't think the booklet was in the original release of this one. Like I said, one of you guys know that this one was available. Anyway, that guys, that's all for the review portion of this video. Thanks again for watching, subscribing, and I'll see you guys later.